are they? Are they important? And what can they tell us? Within archaeology can reconstruct past people's stories and give voices to people who are no longer here. But there's a tendency in archaeology to categorize and use dichotomies to label the artifacts and structures found in the archaeological record. So my question is, is this method useful, or does it ensure the erasure of certain stories of the past? So the first thing I want to talk about is space. So within the field of archaeology, space is incredibly vital to the study of past people. So the landscape of the past is altered and manipulated by the use of space. And I think a really good way to understand this is to think about ourselves, right? So think about the UNM campus. It's humans, a classic example of humans using space, right? So imagine 5,000 years have passed, and archaeologists are coming in and excavating what remains of our school. I don't know, it might still be operating in 5,000 years, we don't know. But what would they find? And what would it tell them about the life, of average Americans, ages 18 to like 21, 22? And if they thought like current archaeologists, they would probably divide the spaces that they found into two categories. So the first one is public space, okay? So this is traditionally large plazas, places of community gathering, and more often than not, they're usually associated with the elites of the past, because elites are usually the ones who are wealthy enough and have enough power to either, to commission the making of such large structures. So usually, public spaces give us insights into more large-scale political, social trends of the community or the society. Some examples of this are like the pyramids of Giza, the Mayan step pyramids, and also like the Roman Colosseum. So big, grandiose structures, right? They don't really tell us much about like individuals. Like looking at this, I don't really know, what did people who walked around this place eat? I can't really tell from this structure. So that leads us to private space. So private spaces, they usually take the form of homes. But not always, they can be different. They're just usually residential spaces. So archaeological study of private spaces, they usually focus on the functions of rooms, the organization of space, and the household economy, usually focusing on like food production and food consumption. And the studies of private spaces, it is becoming a lot more popular in archaeology because I think there's been a realization that public spaces, they don't complete this picture of the average life in a society. So through the study of private spaces, we can learn a lot more about individuals. We can see the types of foods they ate, the tools that were important to them, how they delineated space within their home, the functions of each room, gender separations, if there are any, and how they placed their home within reference to other homes, okay? So let's go back to our UNM example, using our knowledge that we now know about private and public space. So let's think about a place like Smith Plaza. Based on what you guys just learned, do you think it would be a public space or a private space? Public, right, it'd be a public space. And so what would we find? We would find bricks, probably, maybe some seating structures, but more often than not, we probably would just see this outline. It's different than the rest of the area. It's this large, flat surface. And that's how a lot of plazas, especially like in Mayan archaeology, are found. Something we wouldn't find is like a pile of beer bottles, right? We would just find that right in Smith Plaza. And using that information, we might assume, that the average life of a college student 5,000 years ago, did not include drinking, which would be incorrect, right? But we would assume that by using just public space. If we use private space, including like the dorms, okay, that would be considered maybe a private space. It might be, there's some debate about that, it could be. Maybe you would find other stuff like hygiene products, there might be some leftover beer bottles. Like you could inform more about the individual. So what I'm saying is public space does not fill the entire picture. But the question is, do private spaces, does that fill the rest of the gaps? Is that enough? So we move on now to in-between spaces. I believe that we might still be missing something, by using these two spectral extremes, we might be missing stuff that falls in the middle, okay? Is the dichotomy of private and public useful? By setting the types of space we study, study on two spectral streams, right? We are missing anything that falls towards the middle of the spectrum. This is where in-between spaces come into play, and this is a term that I've like come up with. I don't know if there might be a real term for it, but this is what I am calling it. And it's a term I use to talk about spaces that are in the middle of the private and the public, spaces that are domestic and commercial at the same time. And so to explore this question, I think it might be useful to think about a certain example of an in-between space, and that is a brothel. So a brothel, most commonly known, is a place of prostitution, okay? And they are found in the archaeological record. They're hard to identify, okay? And scholarship on it is relatively new, and they're definitely something that I would categorize as an in-between space. So Allison Glazebrook is one of the leading scholars on this subject as brothels. She's very well known in the archaeology of gender field. And so she has a definition for brothel. She says, although Greek comic poets describe commercial places focusing on access to prostitutes, archaeological evidence suggests instead that places of prostitution were multi-purpose, with access to prostitutes being only one commodity of many. So the most important thing to me about this is multi-purposeness, right? It isn't, whatever structure it is, it doesn't serve just one. It isn't just there for sleeping, isn't just there for cooking. It has all these different uses, okay? And then Thomas McGinn is another scholar in this field, and he says, a brothel is an establishment where two or more prostitutes can work simultaneously and whose activities form the main or at least a major part of the business as a whole. And kind of what I take from this, so this definition allows us to assess many structures within the terms of a brothel. So the most important thing for this is that there's lots of aspects, right? There's lots of things. It's the multi-purposeness of it. And that definition can be applied to other in-between spaces. They're not only used for one thing. It's ambiguous. There might be lots of different uses for them. So Allison Glazebrook moves on and she says, definitions might not be the best way to figure out if a space is an in-between space. It might just be the presence of certain items within the structure, okay? So she talks about, you know, if a structure you find, and this specifically is talking about Greco-Roman brothels, just to make that clear, that's probably where most of the scholarship has been done, is on these Greco-Roman in antiquity. And so she talks about a structure being near a port, agora, or a city gate, and agora was like a public park sort of area, because, you know, that's the commercial side of it. It has to be commercial, right? It's a business. That's where people make money. And so it should be in this relatively busy area. Small rooms, because they're public, and many of them, right? Because lots of people have to occupy them. Female-specific items, okay? So things like they found like hairpins that are female-specific, and easy access to water. There are writings that say that in ancient Greece, it was customary to wash yourself after intercourse. So easy access to water would make sense that they would be in that space. Okay, so it is important to note that the presence of only one of these items doesn't identify a structure as a brothel, okay? So moving on to the archaeology of gender. So the archaeology of gender has become increasingly popular in the field since about the 1980s. And there was an assumption earlier on that women will only be found within private spaces. You're only going to find women, female activity in private spaces within the record. But as it's seen through our exploration of brothels, women can also occupy these in-between spaces, okay? And they can play a part in the economical system, manufacturing, and they can also serve food. Things that would not be present in only the private or public. You weren't going to see women doing cool stuff in the public either, right? So we've missed something by only studying the private and the public, okay? We can see women occupying these in-between spaces, and you weren't gonna find them playing these roles using this dichotomization. So what does this all mean, you know? Why are in-between spaces important? So I think that dichotomies are dangerous, and polarizing things to spectral extremes erases what's in the middle. This is relevant today, you know, even like think about categorizing a person. You know, you're essentially putting them in a box and you're not allowing them to deviate at all, you know, from the rules and assumptions associated with that box. And wouldn't it be the same, you know, for the use of space? You know, Other aspects of anthropology have criticized these dichotomies and categories, especially feminist cultural anthropology. And yet, archaeology still tends to categorize. It's either this or that. It's us or them. And this view of the world and the archaeological record is so limited. The job of the archaeologist is to tell the story of the past, but how can we accomplish it if we look to the left or to the right and not to what's directly in the middle? This is why future scholarship must focus on these in-between spaces and try to break these categories and these spectrums. And I think that they will help fill the gaps of what has been missed and tell the stories that have been erased. Thank you. All right, questions? Are there any questions? Yeah.
So Starbucks has come up recently as a third space, which is kind of your definition here, and like racism and problems with third spaces. So do you have anything to add to that? Are you aware of the incident?
No, I'm not.
So, yeah, so I think earlier this week there were two black men in Philadelphia that had just walked into a Starbucks and were just waiting for their friends like we all do. Mm-hmm. And the Starbucks employees called the cops and the guys were arrested basically for being black in Starbucks. Mm-hmm. So it brings up a lot of issues around who is welcome in third spaces and mm-hmm. who's excluded. Mm-hmm. So I was wondering what you would contribute, like from an archaeological point of view.
Right.
How that would work.
So I definitely think, every society is different and every single society's in between or third space, as you're calling it, mm-hmm. They'll have different rules associated with it. So I would say the archaeological record could probably inform very little on that issue. Mm-hmm. We can see, separations of people definitely based on if their skeletal remains, and we can see if people are different from another, and we can tell if they've lived in separate spaces or they were separated, and that's kind of the extent to it, I would believe. I think it's hard because what you're saying is these in-between spaces are ambiguous, right? Which would probably mean that the rules are also ambiguous, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that, shines a lot on that question, just like, who's in charge? Who can dictate things? But I think it's greater than archaeology, and it definitely, talks on a higher level, of our society and the racial problems that we have. But I would say that, I don't know if I would even consider Starbucks to be an in-between space. I'm not sure if I'm on board with that. Just because it's pretty commercial. There are chairs you can sit in. So I guess, but I would, if it is a spectrum and there's this pure in-between space, things can deviate. So I don't know if I would say exactly. Uh-huh. It's more on the commercial side. Uh-huh. And then, that means there are people in charge,
right,
or whatever the commercial is, and they might not be very nice people. But I would say the archaeological record can't inform so much on that. It's definitely, because that's definitely very, very present, very, very modern. So okay. I hope that answers
your
question.
Yes, it does.
Okay. Thanks. Yes?
So from an archaeological perspective, what is there a risk in trying to infer too much from older structures that we don't retain a whole lot of knowledge about?
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I think your knowledge is always limited using this, and inferring too much from a structure is definitely dangerous and almost impossible. And that's why archaeology is all interpretation. That's like all it is. I might see this chair and I will say it has all these attributes and it means this society, was egalitarian because there's so many chairs, everyone's at an equal level, maybe. And then you'll say something completely different. So I definitely think there is a danger in interpreting too much. Hi. But again, like, you're always checked and you're always challenged. There's so many people in the field that will fight you no matter what you interpret, so there's always checking. And I think to a certain extent, a lot of people who study structures like this will say, there's a possibility we don't know. There's a possibility we might be totally wrong. And all you can really do is try, I think, and attempt. You might fall completely short and it's constantly changing. You know, people, you know, in 10 years will totally contradict what people in the past have said and interpreted on a space. But I definitely think there's a lot of checks and balances. You know, there's so many people who are willing to argue with you. So that danger is definitely reduced, I think, through that.